Hi, I'm Yuki, a docent at the Tahoe Environmental Research Center. The beautiful setting of Lake Tahoe is a result of the geological processes that created the Sierra Nevada mountain range and the basin in which the lake formed. The rocks in the basin range from less than a million years old to as old as 360 million years old. Geologists estimate that the formation of the lake itself began about 3 million years ago, when faulting started to create the natural depression that gradually began filling with water and would eventually become the Lake Tahoe Basin. It started as a shallow alkaline lake, and as movement along the faults continued, the lake basin became deeper and continued to fill with water. Many freshwater lakes form and then start to fill with sediment and organic matter, eventually filling to become a middle. The typical lifespan of a lake range from years to thousands of years, but lakes like Tahoe, whose basin have active faults, can continue to deepen even as sediments are deposited. The result is an ancient lake like Lake Tahoe. Throughout the lifespan of this ancient lake, geological processes, large and small, have contributed to alter the shape of the Lake Tahoe Basin. Geologist and fellow docent Francis is here to talk about some of the more remarkable incidents that have occurred here.
Thank you, Yuki. Today, we're on Eagle Rock along the west shore of Lake Tahoe. The mountains to the west of us are the Sierra Nevada, and the mountains across the lake are the Carson Range. I'm going to talk a bit about some recent work published in 2018 and 2019 that provides a more detailed understanding of why this lake is so old and so deep. There are only 20 lakes that have consistently carried water for more than 1 million years. These deep ancient lakes share a common characteristic. They persist due to continued movement along faults. Such lakes can be extremely deep, and they continue to deepen even as sediments accumulate. Lake Tahoe straddles the California-Nevada state line, and it occupies the westernmost basin in the Basin and Range Province, which is here. This part of the Basin and Range Province, including the Lake Tahoe Basin, is part of the Walker Lane, and on this illustration, it's this yellow area here, and right here, the crust is pulling apart. As the Earth's crust pulls apart, cracks or faults form, and ranges rise and basins fall. Geologists call them horsts and grabens, but basically they're ranges and basins. And in Nevada, you can see that the whole state is pretty much covered by basins and ranges. And if you've ever driven across it, you go up and down and up and down and up and down. So that's what the basin and range looks like. This lake, Lake Tahoe, lies in an asymmetric half graben, which is shown here. And a half graben is just a graben that has a fault on just one side. And the fault on this one side, on the west side of Lake Tahoe, is the Tahoe Sierra frontal fault zone. The Tahoe Sierra frontal fault zone is a zone of faults. You see these white strands here that runs between a half and 5 miles west of Lake Tahoe. Movement along this fault started about 3 million years ago. As faulting continues, the lake got deeper and continued to fill with water. Three other faults have also contributed to deepening the basin. There's the West Tahoe Dollar Point Fault that starts at Dollar Point and runs down through the lake parallel to the west shore. There's the North Tahoe State Line Fault that starts at State Line and then runs out into the lake. And then there's the Incline Village Fault that runs through Incline Village and down into the lake parallel to the North Tahoe State Line Fault. Between where we're standing on Eagle Rock here, the red circle, and Emerald Bay down here to the south, geologists have measured as much as 4,500 feet of offset on the Tahoe Sierra frontal fault zone and the North Tahoe Dollar Point fault. And the movement along those faults is down to the east, so like this. Faulting along the Tahoe Sierra frontal fault zone is also responsible for a large-scale collapse event along the west shore of Lake Tahoe. A large earthquake caused nearly 3 cubic miles of material to come out of what is now Mckinney Bay and flow across the bottom of the lake, about 9 miles. It carried mile-sized blocks, and you can see some of them here. Samples dredged from the top of these landslide blocks are poorly cemented lake sediment that closely resembles the shelf off Tahoe City, which is still in place. Before the Mckinney Bay landslide, the shelf off Tahoe City extended all the way to Sugar Pine Point. That landslide removed most of the southern part of the shelf and created this huge amphitheater at the head of Mckinney Bay. The landslide pushed a wall of water about 330 feet tall across the lake to the east, and when it hit the east shore, it was reflected back. So the wall of water going across the first time is a tsunami. The wall of water that's reflected back is called a seiche wave, and seiche waves are sort of like waves in a bathtub. They just slosh back and forth. These waves wash sediment back into the lake and lower the lake level about 33 feet. The lake water was probably muddy for years after this event, and all of the vegetation around the edge of the lake would have been washed away. Eagle Rock, where we're standing, was actually scoured around its base by waves generated by the mega landslide, leaving the promontory that we see today. Scientists estimate the age of this mega landslide to be between 21,000 and 12,000 years old. They know this because waves generated by the landslide eroded a glacial moraine at the mouth of Emerald Bay that was dated at 21,000 years old. And when they sampled the sediments on top of these blocks deep in the lake, they were dated at 12,000 years old. So we know it has to be older than 12,000 and younger than 21,000 years old. Beginning 2.3 million years ago and continuing to 940,000 years ago, small volcanoes erupted from vents like here at Eagle Rock and then north and west of Tahoe City off in that direction, which would be here. This is the Truckee River. These volcanoes produced lavas, cinder cones, and other types of fragmented volcanic rock. Some lava also flowed into an early Lake Tahoe and mixed with wet lake sediments, forming lava deltas that now mark ancient shorelines. Lava flows dammed the Truckee River three times, twice at Rampart and once at Thunder Cliffs. And each dam would raise the lake level, and then the river would come through and erode the dam away. And then there would be another eruption, and the lake level would rise, and then it would be eroded away. After all was said and done, there are now ancient shorelines at least 600 feet above the current lake level. If you've ever floated the Truckee River, you know the canyon isn't all that deep. If these lava flows had not repeatedly dammed the river, the canyon would have been eroded much deeper, and the lake would not be nearly as deep as it is today. The Lake Tahoe region was extensively glaciated at about 69,000 years ago, and again at about 21,000 years ago. Glaciers flowed down valleys tributary to the Truckee River, like Bear Creek and Squaw Creek. When they melted, they left behind piles of soil and rocks called moraines that dammed the river yet again and raised the lake of the level about 560 feet above current levels until those dams were then eroded away. Lake Tahoe itself never held glaciers, but glaciers carved canyons down to the lake that are now some of the most iconic landmarks like Emerald Bay and Cascade Lake. So I hope you enjoyed learning about some of the geologic processes that shape the lake we see today. And I'm going to hand you back to Yuki.
In addition to the geological processes that have shaped Lake Tahoe, we as humans have also played a role in the current state of the lake. Lake Tahoe has 63 streams that bring water into the lake from the surrounding mountains, but there is only one outlet, the Lower Truckee River. A dam was constructed at this outlet, Fanny Bridge, about a century ago. This dam is controlled by the Federal Water Master of Reno, who controls the amount of outflowing water, and therefore the level of the lake, the stream flow velocity of water in the river, and the downcutting of the Truckee River. It's important to realize the role that we as society play in our surrounding environment in everything we do in the watershed affects the lake. So let's work together to keep our environment clean and educate ourselves, as well as others, about responsibility to our home we call Lake Tahoe. Thanks so much for joining me today.